I wish to talk about a human character who arouses conflicting emotions. The do-gooder. I don't mean a part-time, normal do-gooder. Someone who has a worthy job or volunteers at a charity and returns to an ordinary family life in the evenings. I mean a person who sets out to live as ethical a life as possible. I mean a person who's drawn to moral goodness for its own sake. I mean someone who pushes himself to moral extremity, who commits himself wholly beyond what seems reasonable. I mean the kind of do-gooder who makes people uneasy. This person has a sense of duty that is very strong. So strong that he's able to repress most of his baser impulses in order to do what he believes to be right. This is a struggle, but one that he usually wins. He rarely permits himself time off from his work and spends little money on himself, so he has more to give away. He has his joys and pleasures, but they must fit. They must gain admittance. Because of this, there is a certain rigidity and a focused narrowness to the way he lives. His life makes ordinary existence seem flabby and haphazard. The standards to which he holds himself and the emotions he cultivates. Care for strangers. A degree of detachment from family in order to care for those strangers. Indifference to low pleasures can seem inhumanly lofty and separate him from other people. The life of a zealous do-gooder is a kind of human sublime, by which I mean that, although there is a hard beauty in it, the word beautiful doesn't capture the ambivalence it stirs up. A beautiful object, a flower, a stream, is pleasing in a gentle way, inspiring a feeling that is like love. A sublime object, such as a mountain or a rough sea, inspires awe, but also dread. Confronting it, you see its formidable nobility. And at the same time, you sense uncomfortably that you would not survive in it for long. It is this sense of sublime that I mean to apply to do-gooders. To confront such a life is to feel awe mixed with unease, a sense that you wouldn't survive in that life for long and might not want to. The do-gooder is both more and less free than other people. In the usual sense of the word, he is less free. Because he believes it's his duty to act in certain ways, and he has to do his duty. But in an older sense, he is more free, because he can control himself, so his intentions aren't frustrated by weaknesses that he'd rather not have. He knows that if he makes a promise, he will keep it. That if a thing is right, he will do it. That he will not turn away because something seems too hard. Because of this, his life is what he intends it to be. The usual way to do good is to help those who are near you. A person grows up in a particular place, perceives that something is wrong there, and sets out to fix it. Or a person's job suddenly requires heroism of him, and he rises to the occasion. He might be a priest whose church becomes a refuge in wartime, or a nurse working in a hospital at the start of a plague. Either way, he is taking care of his own, trying to make their lives better, lives that he understands because they are like his. He may not know personally the people he's helping, but he has something in common with them. They are, in some sense, his people. There's an organic connection between him and his work. Then there's another sort of person who starts out with something more abstract, a sense of injustice in the world at large and a longing for goodness as such. This person wants to live a just life, feels obliged to right wrongs or relieve suffering, but he doesn't know right away how to do that. So he sets himself to figuring it out. He doesn't feel that he must attend first to people close to him. He is moved not by a sense of belonging, but by the urge to do as much good as he can. There is no organic, necessary connection between him and his work. It doesn't choose him, he chooses it. The do-gooders I'm talking about are this second sort of person. They're not better or worse than the first sort, but they are rarer and harder to understand. It can seem unnatural to look away from one's own people toward a moral idea, but for these do-gooders, it's not. It's natural for them. The first sort of person doesn't provoke the discomfort that do-gooders do. The first person is often called a hero, and hero is a much less ambivalent word than do-gooder. I'm using the word here in a modern colloquial sense. I'm not talking about Achilles. A hero of this type comes upon a problem and decides to help. He is moved to do so by compassion for something he sees, something outside himself. When he's not helping, he returns to his ordinary life. Because of this, his noble act is not felt as a reproach. You couldn't have done what he did because you weren't there. You weren't part of his world. You can always imagine that you would have done what he did if you had been there. After all, the hero is an ordinary person, like you. The do-gooder, on the other hand, knows that there are crises everywhere, all the time, and he seeks them out. He is not spontaneous. He plans good deeds in cold blood. He may be compassionate, but compassion is not why he does what he does. He committed himself to helping before he saw the person who needs him. He has no ordinary life. His good deeds are his life. This makes him good, but it can also make him seem perverse. A foul weather friend. A kind of virtuous ambulance chaser. And it's also why do-gooders are a reproach. You know, as the do-gooder knows, that there is always, somewhere, a need for help. The term do-gooder is, of course, often demeaning. It can mean a silly or intrusive person who tries to do good, but ends up only meddling. It can mean someone who seems annoyingly earnest, or priggish, or self-righteous, or judgmental. Benjamin Franklin gave up his quest for moral perfection when he realized that such extreme nicety as I exacted of myself might be a kind of foppery in morals, which, if it were known, would make me ridiculous. That a perfect character might be attended with the inconvenience of being envied and hated, and that a benevolent man should allow a few faults in himself to keep his friends in countenance. But even when do-gooder simply means a person who does good deeds, there's still some skepticism, even antagonism in it. One reason may be guilt. Nobody likes to be reminded, even implicitly, of his own selfishness. Another is irritation. Nobody likes to be told, even implicitly, how he should live his life, or be reproached for how he is living it. And nobody likes to be the recipient of charity. But that's not the whole story. There's a certain suspicion of do-gooders who work in NGOs because aid money is often wasted and sometimes harms the people it's supposed to help. But that's not the whole story either. Ambivalence toward do-gooders also arises out of a deep uncertainty about how a person ought to live. Is it good to try to live as moral a life as possible, a saintly life? Or does a life like that lack some crucial human quality? Is it right to care for strangers at the expense of your own people? Is it good to bind yourself to a severe morality that constricts spontaneity and freedom? Is it possible for a person to hold himself to unforgiving standards without becoming unforgiving? It is presumptuous, even blasphemous, for a person to imagine that he can transfigure the world, or to believe that it really matters what he does in his life when he's only a tiny, flickering speck in a vast universe. Should morality be the highest human court, the one whose ruling overrides all others? The philosopher Susan Wolf has written that a morally perfect person would be an unappealing, alien creature, driven not by the loves and delights of ordinary people, but by an unnatural devotion to duty. In a life devoted only to duty, there's no room for art, and little for enjoyment. Morality itself, she writes, does not seem to be a suitable object of passion. It is a measure of how peculiar do-gooders have come to seem, that a moral philosopher finds it unnatural to feel passion for morality as such. And Wolf is not the only one who feels this way. A passion for morality is a passion for goodness. Something like a secular version of a passion for God. And that did not used to seem so strange. Wolf argues that if the ideal of the saintly do-gooder is not one we truly aspire to, if we feel that, in their strangeness or self-suppression, such people are missing some crucial human quality, if we believe, in other words, that the moral ideal is not a human ideal, then we should revise our ideas about the place of morality in life. Morality should not be the highest human court, the one whose ruling overrides all others. So, yes, in the ambivalence toward do-gooders, there can be a petty defensiveness, resentment of being reproached, having to justify one's choices. There can be petty annoyance, irritation with earnestness, or self-righteousness, or priggishness. But there are also powerful forces that push against do-gooders which have nothing to do with any of these things, and which are not petty at all. Some of these forces are among the most fundamental, vital, and honorable urges of human life. For instance, there is family, and there are strangers. The do-gooder has a family like everyone else. If he doesn't have children, he has parents, but he holds himself to moral commitments that are so stringent and inflexible that they will, at some point, conflict with his caring for his family. Then he has to decide what to do. To most people, it's obvious that they owe far more to family than to strangers. That's part of the very idea of family. Family means those to whom you owe more. It might seem that caring for your family is the very heart of morality. Charity begins at home. In some situations, it's true. Preferring your family is called nepotism, and it's bad. In other situations, preferring your family is called incest, and is very bad. But to most people, most of the time, the choice between family and strangers is no choice at all. Caring for strangers' children as much as your own, say, would seem not so much difficult as unnatural, even monstrous. But the do-gooder doesn't believe his family deserves better than anyone else's. He loves his more, but he knows that other people love their families just as much. To a do-gooder, taking care of family can seem like a kind of moral alibi, something that may look like selflessness, but is really just an extension of taking care of yourself. Political movements and religious orders have always known that a certain distance from the claims of family, sometimes to the point of celibacy or abandonment, is necessary for a total commitment to something larger. Abraham was ready to sacrifice his son. Agamemnon was ready to sacrifice his daughter. Buddha left his family behind. Saint Francis was brutal to his parents. Gandhi was brutal to his wife. Jesus says in Luke, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own mother, father, and wife, and children, and brothers, and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple." Sometimes, the claims of actual family have not been explicitly rejected, so much as incorporated into spiritual family, to the point of disappearance. All humans become brothers. God becomes a husband. A do-gooder might not go so far as hatred or abandonment, but the fact that he even asks himself how much he should do for his family and how much for strangers, weighing the two together in the same balance, may seem already a step too far. And not all religions permit the neglect of family for the sake of strangers. Under Sharia law, a Muslim must bequeath 2/3 of his estate to his family, unless the family agrees otherwise. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, a wealthy convert, asked Muhammad whether he should leave 2/3 of his estate to charity, since he possessed so much and had only one daughter. The daughter told him he should give away no more than 1/3, lest he leave his daughter destitute. A Jew, by tradition, is obliged to give 10% of his income to the poor, but must give no more than 20%, lest his family become poor itself, a public burden. In the Mishnah, it is written, "If a man assigns his estate to strangers and leaves out his children, his arrangements are legally valid, but the spirit of the sages finds no delight in him." Gandhi believed that the seeker after goodness is obliged to forswear close friendships and exclusive loves, because loyalty may tempt him to wrongdoing and detracts from an impartial love of all mankind. Reviewing Gandhi's memoir, George Orwell found this belief repellent. He wrote, "The essence of being human is that one does not seek perfection, that one is sometimes willing to commit sins for the sake of loyalty, that one does not push asceticism to the point where it makes friendly intercourse impossible, and that one is prepared in the end to be defeated and broken up by life, which is the inevitable price of fastening one's love upon other human beings. It is too readily assumed that the ordinary man only rejects saintliness because it is too difficult. In other words, that the average human being is a failed saint. It is doubtful whether this is true. Many people genuinely do not wish to be saints, and it is probable that some who achieve or aspire to sainthood have never felt much temptation to be human beings." At the same time, Orwell deeply admired Gandhi. Without him, the world would have been worse, and Gandhi could not have accomplished what he did without being the sort of saintly do-gooder that Orwell found so difficult to like. There is one circumstance in which the extremity of do-gooders looks normal, and that is war. In wartime, or in a crisis so devastating that it resembles war, such as an earthquake or a hurricane, duty expands far beyond its peacetime boundaries. In wartime, it's thought dutiful rather than unnatural to leave your family for the sake of a cause. In wartime, the line between family and strangers grows faint, as the duty to one's own enlarges to encompass all the people who are on the same side. It's usually assumed that the reason do-gooders are so rare is that it's human nature to care only for your own. There's some truth to this, of course, but it's also true that many people care only for their own because they believe it's human nature to do so. When expectations change, as they do in wartime, behavior changes too. In war, what in ordinary times would be thought weirdly zealous becomes expected. In ordinary times, to ask a person to sacrifice his life for a stranger seems outrageous, but in war, it is commonplace. Acts that seem appallingly bad or appallingly good in normal circumstances become part of daily life. In wartime, extreme malevolence is excused, and extreme virtue is also excused. People respond to this new moral regime in different ways. Some suffer under the tension of moral extremity and long for the forgiving looseness of ordinary life. Others feel it was the time when they were most vividly alive, in comparison with which the rest of life seems dull and lacking in purpose. In peacetime, selflessness can seem soft, a matter of too much empathy and too little self-respect. In war, selflessness looks like valor. In peacetime, a person who ignores all obligations, who isn't civilized, who does exactly as he pleases, an artist who abandons duty for his art, even a criminal, can seem glamorous because he's amoral but free. But in wartime, duty takes on the glamour of freedom, because duty becomes more exciting than ordinary liberty, and because war permits freedoms unheard of in peacetime, like the freedom to kill. This is the difference between do-gooders and ordinary people. For do-gooders, it is always wartime. They always feel themselves responsible for strangers. They always feel that strangers, like compatriots in war, are their own people. They know that there are always those as urgently in need as the victims of battle, and they consider themselves conscripted by duty. So is it good to try to live as moral a life as possible? Or is there something in the drive to extraordinary goodness that distances a person too much from ordinary humanity? I don't think this question can be answered in the abstract. In the abstract, there are ideas about saints and perfection. Only actual lives convey fully and in a visceral way the beauty and cost of a certain kind of moral existence. For this reason, most of this book consists of stories about the lives of do-gooders, how they arrived at the moral principles they live by, and the choices they chose to face. Some of these things are tiny, everyday choices that only a do-gooder's intense scrutiny would see as a moral choice at all. Whether to move a worm from a path, whether to buy an apple. Other choices are large and dreadful. One do-gooder decides she's willing to die in political protest, but knows that if she does, she will abandon her son. A husband and wife create a refuge for lepers in a wilderness, knowing that their children may catch leprosy or be eaten by panthers. Are all these choices these do-gooders have made the right ones? I don't know. Neither do they. It's a measure of their seriousness that they doubt and question themselves. These do-gooders are very different from one another. Some are religious, others are not. Some have no children, others have dozens. Some care deeply about animals, others don't at all. Some think that suffering is pointless and wish it could be eliminated. Others believe it makes compassion possible and is at the core of the human condition. They come from different walks of life in different parts of the world. One thing they have in common is that they consider it their duty to help other people. This is the form their morality takes. They are not interested in purity or asceticism. None of them is a world historical figure. They are not Gandhis or Mother Teresa's. Most famous do-gooders come to public attention because they have a genius unrelated to their goodness. They are entrepreneurs, or political leaders who found institutions, or alter the fates of populations, and are judged on their success. But I want to separate the moral urge from those grand forces, to try, insofar as it is possible, to see it by itself. Do-gooders are eccentrics, but their influence extends beyond themselves, because where there's a sense that do-gooders are too eccentric, too distant from other people, there is also a sense that doing good may be responsible for that distance. When there's a sense that extreme morality conflicts with humanity, there is also a fear that to push yourself morally is to distance yourself from human fellowship. Ambivalence about do-gooders can make trying to live a more moral life seem less appealing, less necessary. You may wonder, do do-gooders understand that it is flawed humans, weak humans, ordinary humans whom we love? And if do-gooders are always thinking of how the world is unjust and needs to be changed, if they want to replace our world with another, better one, then do they love the world that we know, which is the world as it is?